Hello and welcome to Deits Sports Talk. I'm your host, Robert Dieters. I've not done a Deits Sports Talk in a long time. And, I got a special guest here, Kevin Nene, a guy that's been a partner with me, a partner in crime for back in the high school days. Well, now he's a big guy for the Warriors. Recently, he's doing D-League now for them. I wanted to bring him on for some insight on Golden State. Some big trades have been going on, so let's bring on Kevin. Hey, Kevin, long time no talk. How you doing, man?
Hey, great, man. Good to hear from you, Robert. How's it going?
I'm doing good, and, talking about the Warriors, I really want to talk to you about how the Warriors losing Jarrett Jack and Carl Landry, is Andre Iguodala the answer for the Golden State Warriors at this point?
Well, I think he's certainly an answer to get them closer to their ultimate goal of an NBA title. It's certainly a great part to an answer. I think that, you get your guy who can really defend perimeter guys. You have your quote-unquote Kobe stopper or a guy who can contain LeBron James now. And, of course, Andre Iguodala, he might not be the guy who won the 2006 slam dunk contest, whatever year it was, one of the craziest dunks I've ever seen, but he still has some athleticism. And he still knows how to put the biscuit in the basket. So here's a guy who can really do it at both ends of the floor, and I think he is going to get him a step closer to getting to an NBA championship.
Because Jarrett Jack and Landry, it's tough because those guys were one of the best bench players we've ever had, and now you have signings of Jermaine O'Neal, Tony Douglas. Are those two going to make a big impact? Because you got one guy that is a point guard, and he isn't as good as Jarrett Jack, but he can help out Steph Curry time in and time out. And then you have Jermaine O'Neal. Him and Bogut can switch off. Which one is the better matchup, you think? Tony Douglas with Steph Curry or Jermaine O'Neal with Andrew Bogut?
Well, I think you were going to be more likely to see Steph and Tony on the floor at the same time. But where's Tony's super big with Jermaine O'Neal and Andrew Bogut? But the thing about, signing these veterans is that your starters aren't going to win every game for you. There are going to be nights where Steph Curry's off, where Klay Thompson's off, where Iggy's off, where Harrison Barnes is off, and it's going to come down to guys who need to provide a boost off the bench, and that's one thing that certainly Tony Douglas can do. Tony Douglas, he might be a streaky shooter, but when he's on, he is on. And that's one thing he can kind of provide like Jarrett Jack did this last year. He can get on a hot streak and carry the team for a couple of minutes when they need a shot in the arm. As far as Jermaine O'Neal, he can still provide some good defense. He does have a lot of mileage on him, but he's still a veteran player. Smart guy who's been in the NBA for a while, and he does know how to score as well. He's perhaps not what he used to be. He certainly isn't what he used to be, but he can still play the game of basketball at a high level.
Now let's go to the Western Conference. As you have the Clippers now. They re-signed CP3. You got Jared Dudley, JJ Redick. You got Matt Barnes re-signing. You got Collins coming back. All of these guys coming back for the Clippers. Chauncey Billups is gone, but you still have Jamal Crawford. These guys have a great bench right now. Do you think this is actually going to be real competition between Golden State and the Clippers? Because last season, Golden State dominated that series. Do you think Golden State can dominate again?
Well, here's one thing. I'll say it's a rhetorical question. Who 3 or 4 years ago would have said that the Golden State Warriors and the Los Angeles Clippers are going to be the two top teams in the Pacific Division? The turnaround that these teams have had in such a short amount of time is pretty remarkable. For teams that hadn't made the playoffs in a very long time and had never really been consistent playoff contenders, since the 70s for the Golden State Warriors, or the early 90s for the Golden State Warriors and the Clippers since, never. So it's going to be another fierce battle between these two teams for the top spot in the Pacific. Unless the Lakers pull off something really unexpected in these next couple of weeks or whatever, it's going to come down to those two teams again. That's how it looks like, at least.
And, let's go to the Lakers side here. The Lakers, you were thinking coming into last season, you got Steve Nash, you got Kobe Bryant, and you got Dwight Howard, and Paul Gasol, those four guys, they couldn't do anything. This team, I think the Lakers just bought players that didn't buy chemistry. And, you know, now Dwight Howard's going to Houston, and now big comments are coming out. Oh, well, hey, you know, Steve Nash is saying, well, Dwight Howard didn't even want to be a Laker. He wasn't comfortable here. I don't think he ever wanted to be a Laker. No. Kobe Bryant saying, oh, well, good for him. He's leaving, blah, 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 and he's doing a lot better. What do you think of this whole Dwight Howard situation, the drama in L.A.?
Well, it's not quite L.A. without some drama, so that's sort of a given. And this worked out beautifully for the Rockets. Now they have a team that can contend in the West. As far as L.A., Bill Simmons made an interesting point in his article he read in Grantland yesterday, about potentially trying to blow this team up. It's not going to happen because Kobe Bryant's still playing, and he is as hungry as ever for ring number six. So they're not going to blow the team up. They can contend for a playoff spot, but a lot of people would talk about, you know, how much Dwight Howard complained and, you know, this, that, and the other thing. He's still a 17-point, 12-rebound-a-night kind of guy. That's going to be very tough to replace. I mean, Chris Kaman is a capable big man, but he's not Dwight Howard. But certainly is going to take the Lakers down a few notches.
Lakers not look so good this year coming in. And, you know, let's look at also San Antonio this year. You know, San Antonio's getting old, but they did make it to the NBA Finals. Probably could have won the championship, but fell short against the Heat. Do you think the Spurs still have a chance to make that NBA Finals, or do you think maybe some other new teams in the Western Conference, you know, maybe Houston, LA, or Golden State, can maybe step up and take that spot?
Well, the 2012-2013 NBA season taught us anything about anything. Is that you should never count out the San Antonio Spurs. I mean, this is a team that had it, that lost 2 years ago in the first round in six games. Really should have been five as the number one seed against Memphis Grizzlies, saved for a miraculous, I think it was a Gary Neal 3-10 game five to overtime. Last year, they blew a 2-0 series lead against the Oklahoma City Thunder. But this year, they had a little help with Russell Westbrook getting injured, a little or a lot, and that's for you to decide. But, you know, they took the best team in the NBA by far, the Miami Heat, to 5 seconds away from defeating them in the NBA Finals. This team, yeah, they're going to be a year older next year, but Tim Duncan had a renaissance year. You know, Manu Ginobili, he might be getting old, but he could still play. He did have his turnover troubles down the stretch a couple of times in those NBA Finals. Tony Parker still is as good as ever. Kawhi Leonard, this is a guy, a young up-and-comer who can really play. And you can never count out the Spurs scouting services overseas and when they look in the collegiate ranks. And there's always going to be a guy or two you don't know about that's going to really, you know, blossom. And it could be a guy like Nando DeColo next year, a guy who spent some time in the D League for them with the Austin Toros. They're always going to have guys, and they still have that big three.
I think the Western Conference is going to be competitional, and I just want to ask you a couple more questions on East. We're going to the other side, the Eastern Conference. Now, this has been probably the biggest, this is one of the biggest things I've ever seen in the Eastern Conference. Celtics lose pretty much their, I think, two best players, and they lose Jason Terry, which is one of their best players as well. You lose three big guys there, and they go to Brooklyn. And now you see Miami getting some competition. The Knicks can be in competition at this point. What do you think the Eastern Conference is going to be have a lot more competition this year?
I still kind of see the Eastern Conference as a five-horse race. So five teams that are legitimately good to very good, those teams being Miami, Brooklyn, New York, a couple of teams are escaping me, hold on, Indiana and Chicago. So those five teams are legitimately good teams. You can make a case, some sort of case, that Miami's still ahead of the pack. You can make a case for those other teams to make the Eastern Conference Finals and push Miami a little bit. And I kind of take a look at the other 10 teams, and you got to feel like every one of those teams thinks they can make the playoffs, because I think those bottom three spots are wide open. It looks like Monte Ellis isn't going to be a Milwaukee Buck next year, so they lose one of their leading scorers. They were the eighth like Cleveland has made a lot of moves, and you know, with Andrew Bynum coming in, they have a couple of first-round draft picks, including the number one guy, Anthony Bennett. This is a team that probably is going to go into next year feeling like they should be a playoff team. The Detroit Pistons are trying to relive their 2004 days, bringing back Chauncey Billups. Perhaps this is a team that's made a couple of nice moves. Perhaps they feel like they can be an 8 seed. Charlotte's throwing some money around. So, yeah, I mean, those bottom three spots are wide open. I don't think any teams could get to the second round of the playoffs, but they can get out of the lottery.
And, bringing up Chicago, you know, Chicago Bulls, they didn't have D. Rose most of that season. They didn't have Luol Deng. Luol Deng got hurt, and now Marco Bellinelli is gone. Nate Robinson's still a free agent at this point. You think Chicago can, I think out of the two teams that could beat Miami, I think it's Brooklyn and Chicago. Which team do you think has more likely of a chance to beat them?
I think, you know, with Derrick Rose coming back, you really have to think about Chicago. But don't count out Indiana. I mean, this team took the Miami Heat to a seventh game. And if they win game one, which isn't all that unfathomable, I mean, they were LeBron James way up at the buzzer away from winning that game. They would have won that game, and they would have won that series in six. Now, obviously, it would have been a little different how the series played out, I think, if Miami lost that game. But they're still a team that took Miami to the brink. So I think you really have to look at Indiana still as a serious contender.
I agree with that. Indiana has been competitional all this year, and they're one of the more underrated teams in the Eastern Conference. A lot of people thought coming in this season, oh, they're not going to be that good, you know. And then you look at it, they're pretty damn good in my opinion. They did pretty well. They went to Game 7, of course. But you also saw in the playoffs way too much injuries. And that's what I think killed a lot of teams. Which team do you think had the biggest injury in that playoff run?
Oh, it's got to be Oklahoma City and Russell Westbrook. I mean, with him, they were probably going to go to the NBA Finals. Without him, they lose in the second round in five games to the Memphis Grizzlies. So he was sorely missed in that series, and they get him back next year, they're going to be back at the top of the heap.
All right, well, thanks, Kevin, so much for being on my show. It's been a while since I talked to you, and, I hope everything goes well with your NBA D-League, and good luck in Vegas for the summer camp.
All right, hey, thanks so much, Robert. Great to talk to you.
All right, talk to you later, Kevin. That was one of my longtime partners, Kevin, and he's been a partner in crime with me for a while. You know, we had our good football days back in Sarah Padres, and, we loved broadcasting with each other. It was an awesome. Now he's moved on to big and better things, and, you know, I'm kind of jealous of that. I'm trying to work towards that goal. I'm trying to work towards being with him. We're going to take a commercial break here, but when we come back, I'm going to talk about more NBA. We're going to talk more about the Dwight Howard situation, Meta World Peace getting released today. And James McDaniels is going to give us more info about that. Josh Smith going to the Pistons. Was it a good decision? Lamar Odom going back to the Lakers? Just some things to think about. We'll be back right after this commercial break. My life's riding on an autobahn, on autopilot. Before I touch dirt, I kill y'all with kindness. I kill ya, my natural persona is much worse. You've been warned if you've been born or if you conform. Slap up a cop and snatch him out of his uniform. Leave him with socks, hard bottoms, and bloomers on. And hang him by his balls from the horn of a unicorn. Y'all niggas intellect mad slow, y'all facts know. Claiming you banging, you flaming. Bet you can light your own cigarette with your asshole. Me and Shady dead at the pass, so that basically resurrected my cash flow. I might rap tight as the snatch of a fat dyke, though I ain't rap tight. My blood type's the 80s. My 90s was like the Navy, you was like the Brady's. You still fly kites daily. Catch me in my Mercedes, bumping ice, ice, baby, screaming shady till I die. Like I have a paradise, life's crazy, so I live it till the fullest, till I'm Swayze, and you only live it once. So I'm thinking about this nice, nice land. Wait, don't stop me now before I get on a roll. Let me tell you what this pretty little dame's Hello and welcome back to Deits Sports Talk. I'm your host Robert Deers, and to recap, I was with Kevin Denae, a guy that has been around has been a partner with me during the Sarah Padre football season my last year, and he's been a great partner. So I actually got another guy on the line, the famous James McDaniels from the NASCAR NBA Half Power Hour, and also the Extra Yard. This guy's done a lot for Spreaker and national sports, and you know, let's bring him on right now, and he's waiting patiently. Hey, James, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
It's good to have
you on my show yesterday.
Yes, and it's good to have you on, and you know, we're gonna talk more NBA, James. Let's go to Dwight Howard. Dwight Howard having all the drama in LA. Steve Nash saying, "Oh, you know, he didn't really want to be a Laker anyway. He didn't feel comfortable here." And now Kobe went off saying today, oh, well, good for Dwight. He gets to go off to another team and all that stuff. Now, with the Lakers, is this – do you think Dwight Howard was really just was not interested in even re-signing with the Lakers at all?
Well, I mean, based on what the players are saying, I mean, that's one thing, but I think you kind of have to look at the performance that the guy did the last year with the Lakers. And I mean, Howard really did not do well with the Lakers. And I mean, if a player does not want to be with the team, he's not going to play at his best. So, I mean, you've seen Dwight Howard back when he was in Orlando. He was just so, he just dominated everything. And now, Once he got to LA, things just started going downhill real fast in his career. His stats went down. He just wasn't the same guy as we saw in Orlando. So, honestly, I actually will give the benefit of the doubt to the players like Kobe Bryant and Steve Nash, who said that Dwight Howard did not want to sign or re-sign with the Lakers because, you know, we just haven't seen it out of Dwight, because if he really did want to play for the Lakers, then he would be playing his heart out, but he's not. So now that he's going to Houston, he says Houston was his decision, not anybody else's. So I think we're going to see the old Dwight Howard back in the NBA when he goes to Houston.
And, you know, speaking of Houston now is pretty set right now. They got three-point shooting. They got their floor general, their point guard, Beverly. And Beverly, Harden, and Chandler Parsons are all good three-point shooters. And you got Thomas Robinson becoming a sophomore, and now you have Dwight Howard. How will Dwight Howard fit into this lineup for the Houston Rockets?
Well, I think you got to look at the rebounding there for the Rockets. The Rockets themselves actually have a very interesting team. I mean, they don't have, like, superstars, but they don't have any, you know, not good players either. They have a lot of good and great players. They just don't have, you know, either top tier or low tier. So, I mean, they're really right in the middle with Harden and Jeremy Lin. I mean, you've got good shooters in those guys. I think Dwight Howard, his main job, since he can't really score anything outside of 10 feet, and he can barely make a free throw if he's lucky, they're going to be using him for rebounding, and I think that's the big thing that Houston's definitely going to want to use out of him. Of course, if he can score, do that, and if they want to get the ball inside of Dwight Howard and then kick it out to, you know, get all the attention of all the guys in there to try to, you know, cover Dwight Howard, and then Dwight Howard just pops it right out to one of the guards, like Harden or Jared Wynn, and they can just shoot up and make a three. So I think for Howard, he's going to be both a facilitator and a rebounder. And a facilitator, not like a point guard, he'll just have everybody come and be a distraction, basically. He'll be a distraction, and then the ball will get to the wide-open guy, and, you know, you're gonna score points. So that's who I see Dwight Howard as. He'll be a scorer, and he'll be a facilitator to get guys wide open from downtown.
And we'll see what happens with Houston. I think they're a pretty good contender this year. Let's go to Kobe and LeBron. I think, you know, I think LeBron has been thinking, you know, next year, where do I want to go? Do I want to go back to Cleveland, be with my hometown? Maybe try to make up for what he did back there, because he did not make a good impression at all after he left. None of the fans were happy with him. Now, let's go to, you know, see where LeBron will go. Do you think there's a possibility between Kobe and LeBron being players on the same team in L.A.?
Well, I wouldn't read just a few minutes ago that Kobe Bryant said that he doesn't think it's a stretch to say that LeBron James would be coming to a race. So what he meant by that is that, you know, he thinks that it's a strong possibility that LeBron James will end up in LA come next free agency period. But the question you got to ask yourself, if you're LeBron James, I mean, you left Cleveland, it would be really hard to go back because the fans are not going to treat you the same as they did the first time you were there, because they're going to feel betrayed still after all these years. I mean, there's always going to be a little bit of feeling, regardless of how long it's been since you've been traded. But you also have to ask yourself the question, should I just stay with Miami? I mean, they've got me 2 championships in a row. I mean, we're a strong contender for a third. If we don't, I mean, really, this team that I'm on right now, it's either championship or bust. So, LeBron James, if he were smart, if he was given enough money on his next contract to be able to say that, yeah, the Heat have given me a legitimate offer, I think it's very negotiable. If he gets an offer he likes, basically, from the Heat, then I would say LeBron James should stay with the Heat, because he proves that he has worked well with the Heat. Like I said, he's got 2 championships now under his belt. He's finally got that no NBA championship thing out of his head. He's worked really well with Chris Bosh, Dwayne Wade, Ray Allen, and all the other guys on the team. So, I mean, why change up a championship team that's won 2 straight already? That's what LeBron James has to ask himself. Now, if he goes over to LA, he's got a question to ask himself, too, there as well. He's got to say, well, Kobe Bryant, Kobe Bryant can guard, and LeBron James is a third. But Kobe Bryant right now is kind of the main point guard on the Lakers. So LeBron James, he's very good at passing the ball in the open court, you know, to get alley-oops and stuff. He can actually make good passes to make good plays. He's not afraid to pass the ball instead of not be a ball hog. However, Kobe Bryant can't be a ball hog at times. So I don't know if that combination would work. It would be a good, like, they're really good on the All-Star team together, but the question LeBron has to ask himself is, would Kobe Bryant pass me the ball to pass to other people, or would Kobe Bryant just go and take the ball himself? Does he trust me enough to be able to try to become, you know, I think, in my opinion, if he's going to go to L.A., LeBron should be treated more as a point guard than a forward, because LeBron can make a lot better passes and makes more passes than Kobe Bryant does. So that's the question he has to ask himself there.
All right. That's a good answer, and I agree with you on that. I mean, you got Kobe there that can shoot well, and then you got LeBron, too, and LeBron's got to learn how to pass more. He can't be the guy who they rely on now. I want to talk about one more question before you go, James. I want to go to New York Knicks. Carmelo Anthony has been saying Rajon Rondo might be coming to the Knicks. And after a torn ACL injury, you know, I think the Knicks are kind of highly interested in him. Do you think Rajon Rondo might go to the New York Knicks during this free agency?
Well, to answer that question, I'll refer a little bit to an answer I got regarding a question regarding Rajon Rondo during during one of my past shows about 2 weeks ago. Jason was on, and he was talking, and I was talking about where Rajon Rondo makes a good fit for the new Celtics coach. And in his opinion, he said that Rajon Rondo would never work out with the coach that they have with the Celtics. So, if that is true, if Rajon Rondo wants to make this his team now that all the stars are on, he's now the new one-time star show on the Celtics right now that Paul Pierce and Kevin Garnett and Jason Terry have left. So now he can take over the team with his good passing and his triple bubbles and things like that. Now, would he be able to work with the coach? That is the question. If he is able to work with the coach, then I don't see any reason why he would not to leave the Celtics, because the Celtics, they do make the playoffs. Now, whether they get very far or not is, you know, something that they're having trouble doing right now, but at least they're making the playoffs. So that's one thing. The Knicks also are making the playoffs, but he's also got to figure, can I make a good fit in New York? Would I be able to work well with Carmelo Anthony? Would I be able to work well for all the other Knicks players and make this team even better than what right now it is. So that's the question that Ray Romano has to ask himself. I mean, obviously, New York can probably offer Ray Romano a humongous contract, so the money's going to be there for Romano. There ain't no doubt about it. The one question he has to ask himself is, which team am I going to be able to play better for? Because he's a guy that will pass, he will rebound, he will score. So if he has good teammates, he's going to excel. So whatever team he feels like is going to be the better fit for him in terms of getting, you know, all those triple doubles and player chemistry and stuff like that, that's the team going to go to.
All right, well, that's a good opinion. And, you know, the Knicks said, you know, he's a real legit point guard, and they want someone that can pass the ball, someone who's a floor general for them, and they think he's a good fit. So we'll see how it all plays out. And, you know, I'm hoping Rajon Rondo does go to the New York Knicks. I think the New York Knicks would be a lot better team, even with Carmelo, J.R. Smith, and Amari Stoudemire. So, you know, let's see what happens with that. And, James, thank you so much for being on my show. Any last comments before you go?
All right. I wish I'm talking to you, Robert.
All right. Thanks, James. And James McDaniels from National Sports. And, you know, we're going to take a quick break. I'm going to stop talking about NBA. And I'm going to go on to some NFL. I'm going to go with Alfonso Denard getting arrested for his second DUI in 15 months. Talking about that with the Patriots. We'll be back right after this commercial break. A lost or found love. Lying by his side.
Take another second to keep breathing in the moment. Never know when love is lost until you find just what it costs to be wrong. I wonder if you think of me passing by, you think you see me coming. I wonder if you pull me in, kiss me just one time again. Thank you.
Welcome back to Deets Sports Talk, and we're going to go to the NFL section. I also got one more special guest coming on, Steven News, and let's go now. We got Alfonso Dinard. We got a second DUI in 15 months for the New England Patriots, and, you know, dealing with a lot of pressure right now, you have to feel bad for, you know, the Patriots with Aaron Hernandez, you know, having all that legal situation going on with the homicide. It's not been pretty for the Patriots. I mean, they struggled way too much. And, you know, how they're going to handle this, are they going to release Alfonso? We don't know yet. That's up to the New England Patriots organization. And they're very disappointed with Alfonso right now. And they're trying to figure out what they can do right now with him at this point. There hasn't been any big decisions. I know on Twitter there was a post saying, oh, we're very disappointed of how this came out of Alfonso with the second DUI. We are going to handle this appropriately and accordingly. And I don't know about their consequence yet, if there will be one or not. And there should be, because, I mean, especially now, I mean, you got Aaron Hernandez just gets released. And, you know, it has not been good for anybody at this point. Let's move on. Let's go to Jets training camp. So much fun to talk about. Mark Sanchez and Geno Smith going at it 1v1. And, you know, the update saying Mark Sanchez is impressing the coach. He accepts the challenges going forward towards this training camp for the Jets. Geno Smith, you know, it's just interesting how they're saying that Geno Smith isn't ready to become a starting QB yet. Mark Sanchez, if he, you know, he has to really prove himself, really improve himself with the organization to really see what will happen with this situation at this point. But let's go on to a bigger topic, Denver Broncos. Broncos executives had BAC levels way over limit. Broncos director of player personnel Matt Russell's blood alcohol content was measured at an 0.246 when he was arrested on July 6, as well as Tom Hecker, the Denver Broncos director of personnel, was arrested June 11th on drunk driving charges. The Broncos publicly have indicated that both men will be punished and the discipline should be significant. Well, you know, you have to agree with that. I mean, these guys now make the Broncos organization look bad. And just all this offseason has not been good at all so far in this one. And now Denver has struggled a lot more. And this is a good team. They're executives. It's not even players at this point. It just happens to be executives that have been going on with this. And it's just not good for the organization. It doesn't make them look good. It's like the Patriots. I mean, you could pair both of these teams right now that have just not had good luck with anything right now. And pretty much that's all I have to say on that right now. Let's go to Russell Westbrook. He was number 12 in the top 32 QBs. RG3 was number 13. A lot of people saying RG3 was surprising to be number 13. Well, he's just a rookie right now, and you can't be questioning that right now. You have to wait until he develops. His second year could be a lot more better, but coming off the LCL and ACL injuries, he's really got to prove himself to play again, and, you know, let's see what happens. I mean, you got weeks, about 4 weeks away from spring training, I mean, from when they have preseason, and I can't wait to be watching that. Russell Westbrook, number 12, that makes a lot more sense, in my opinion. You know, he really brought his team. You know, they did beat the Niners, and Russell Westbrook has really led this team as a rookie. He beat Matt Flynn over the job, and I think one of the best draft picks for the organization was the was getting Russell Westbrook, no doubt. So, you know, just number 12, I think it's a good pick, and you know, I really am going to be interested in seeing who's the top 10 or 11 in this one. I know I just can't wait until, you know, NFL keeps on bringing out these more improved QBs. So, you know, that's really all I say about the NFL. NFL doesn't have a lot to talk about right now. So, Victor Cruz, I know, got his contract extension. Impressive for him, and Harry Nix get his chance of getting a big and better contract for the New York Giants to come, and also as well as Eli Manning, but he has a couple of years left in him, as touched by Nick Rice and Andrew Goldstein. You know, I'm going to actually get my friend on for the baseball segment here. I'm going to get Steven Hughes on, and we're going to talk about Puig, about the Yankees, and maybe some other big topics in the MLB. We are getting new, more and more people for the national sports team, which I'm very happy about, as we are doing better and better as it goes on for this season to come. And looks like I got Steven Hughes on the line here. Hey, Steven, how's it going?
Hey, well, Robert, thanks for, you know, letting me be on your show again. It's an honor. It's great to have
well,
a good friend like you. So, you know, got it. It's nice and let's get started.
Yeah, let's get started, and me and Steven have our Giants fantasy. Check that out whenever you have the chance. But you gotta go back and understand what we're talking about in those certain episodes. But I think you'll get it. So let's move on. Let's go with Puig from the Dodgers. Does not get the nod for the All-Star game. And on top of it, Luis Gonzalez, supposed to be a Hall of Famer soon for the Diamondbacks in 2001, won the World Series for them. Try talking to Puig in his own native language, talking about his family, and Puig was just ignoring him, but talks to the media today and says, oh, it wasn't even that bad, we just had a simple talk, and also has a stare at Miguel Montero. What's up with Puig right now, Steven? Is just because being here from America less than a year, is he still adjusting to the media in America?
Yeah, but I think so, especially the fact that, he's been given so much stardom as he's begun his career in a high media market team such as the Los Angeles Dodgers, have so much pressure with so many superstars in his team, like Keely Ramirez, Adrian Gonzalez, Clayton Kershaw, to rise up above the standards and win the World Series for the Dodgers. And when he started in the beginning of June, Dodgers were in a big slump. They weren't having a great start to the year. They're below 500. Then throughout the month of June, and it continues right now into July into the All-Star break that should be after this weekend, he's been just amazing for the Dodgers. And I think that it's gone too fast for him to really, you know, get adjusted for the media to be on it all the time, to have high standards for him. He's batting 400. And what will the media say if he has a bit of a slump? Is Puig mania over as such? And that's the problem that I have with starting your career and doing really well to begin your career in Los Angeles. Kind of relates to the Fernando Valenzuela, the mania, Fernando mania, back in the 80s, starting pitcher for the Dodgers was doing amazing, won Cy Young, won a rookie of the year, and then kind of faded away the next few years. And I feel like if the media catches up to Puig too much, then that could possibly be the case. But I don't think it will be because the talent is amazing. But, you know, I think that he's handling fine, especially since it's going, like I said, a little too quick for him to really get adjusted to it.
And yes, I think Puig is still trying to adjust into, you know, being American, understanding the media. Do you think Puig deserved to be an All-Star this year?
I don't really have an answer right now. There are major reactions, not just for myself, but from, fellow baseball players, writers. For me, I would say probably, if I had the answer right now, I'd probably have to say no. Jonathan Papelbon had a statement relating to Puig being All-Star as an absolute joke, and I think Papelbon threw a little bit too far, but the fact that Puig had 1 month to play and is batting 400 is obviously it's a great mark to start on. His numbers in the month of June, they are compared to Joe DiMaggio in his rookie year. That's ridiculous. And, I don't think he would be an All-Star. I don't think he is an All-Star because, an All-Star is to prove himself that he is the best player in the league, or in the respective league, the American League and nationally, for the first half of the year. But I feel like some people are overrating Puig as an All-Star, underrating some other players. Look at Michael Gaudier for the Rockies. He has, a 28-game hitting streak that he still has going on. He's only a reserve. Bryce Harper's a starter, and he's the starting outfielder. The fan voting is, motivated by the media, and the media takes too much on certain individual players like Bryce Harper, the hype over when he's getting called up. And I feel like he's doing better than Bryce Harper, but Bryce Harper is getting all the fan vote. So, players are getting snubbed out, but I think that, in my opinion, for the final vote in the National League, is incredibly great that Freddie Freeman got the nod. His numbers are throughout the entire first half of the year, and not just for Puig, which is just a month and a couple of weeks.
And Puig has done impressive, and, let's see what happens in the future. This Dodger team is looking pretty good, catching up to the Diamondbacks. And Diamondbacks, the NL West has not been a very competitional division. They're, even the worst teams, like the Giants, are like maybe 7 games back, something like that. But let's move on to New York. As the Yankees get Derek Jeter back, and I believe they're playing right now as Derek Jeter is DH. Are you excited Derek Jeter's back, Steven, and ready to play for the Yankees?
I think it's a spark for the Yankees to have Derek Jeter back. They're not doing bad, especially with the fact that their 3 stars have been out for most of the year, and Derek Jeter just played a few double-A games and then coming back today. He wasn't even supposed to come back today. He's supposed to come back Friday, but Travis Hafner fouled a pitch on his foot and couldn't play today, so they had to call Jeter up today. Another star is Curtis Granderson. He's broken his hand twice in a year's span, and he's been out for a long time, and he's not expected to be, clear to play for another couple of weeks. And Alex Rodriguez is expected to be coming up in the next 10 to 14 days. That's what the Yankees GM Brian Cashman told ESPN Jeremy Schaaf. Just thinking about that, that's a good thing for A-Law, but it comes with a bad thing that with all the biogenesis going on with A-Rod, that could be a problem for the Yankees. But going straight to Jeter, it's good that Jeter's back. He went 1-for-4 today, got an RBI run, but he had to leave the game with minus in his quad, and that questions the fact why did the Yankees call him up so fast. And like I said, Travis Hafner was hurt, and Jeter needed to play DH. But I feel like Jeter is in 100% ready to call him back. He's 95% ready. He had a couple of hitters in AAA, so he'll have to get back from the groove if the Yankees want to. He gets more comfortable playing everyday baseball shortstop like he used to in the past before his injury.
And I think Jeter is going to help out this team, as Kevin Youkilis has also been hurt, and a lot of people on the DL from the Yankees, but they still have stayed in competition, even without their best players, and they've done pretty impressive. Let's move on to A-Rod. A-Rod might be coming back, but Biogenesis, he's getting an interview. I believe it was today or tomorrow he's having an interview about it, but no one has talked up yet. And about 20 to 25 players can be suspended for 100 games. Steven, is this a big issue for some of these clubs? Especially some of these guys are going to be all-stars. And how much does this affect every ball club that have players involved?
I like to start going straight after A-Rod. Frank Cashman was asked about A-Rod's involvement in the Biogenesis situation, and Cashman didn't really have anything to say. It's pretty much all like an individual thing. It doesn't involve the team, really. So it's more of A-Rod's issue, not A-Rod and the Yankees' issue. But then, in a whole, it's a big problem for Major League Baseball, that the fact that PEDs are possibly coming back in a very secretive way, especially with Ryan Braun, the notable one, including A-Rod. Another one is Bartolo Colon. Like you said, there's some all-stars in this list of suspected PED users, all Biogenesis. Bartolo Colon had 12 wins in the first half of the year since he won the Cy Young with the Angels back in 2006. So obviously that says a lot about, you know, he used it. He got suspended for it last year. So is he still using it to make him a better pitcher? And he's still throwing 93. He's like the age of 35, 36. You think that his arms would start to go dead by the age of 32, or start to go down to around, if you're throwing 95, you're throwing 92, 93, 91. But it's a bit of a surprise for me that, all of these players are going to be suspended possibly 50 or 100 games. But I'll be more surprised if Ryan Braun and A-Rod don't get the 100-game suspension. I feel like Ryan Braun is just rejecting all questions about it. He refused to answer questions to Major League Baseball. And A-Rod, who's expected to talk to Major League Baseball tomorrow about it, can really say anything about the situation. He'll probably defend himself, but I feel like at the end of the day, Major League Baseball will take action with the suspension of Braun and Rodriguez.
Fortunately, this is the case, and this is something baseball does not want right now, especially with a good season coming, and MLB has to deal with this situation very seriously. And, Steven, I want to say thank you for being on my show and talking about the MLB segment. I haven't done MLB in so long, and I'm starting to follow back on it again, but I've been more on the NBA side. So, Steven, any last comments before you go?
I want to bring up the fact that when NBA 2K14 comes out, I'll be purchasing it. Actually, I'm pre-ordering it, and I will be commentating games that are affiliated with my season mode. Who knows which team I'll be on. The teams will be so much different heading to the 2014 year. Example, Iguodala going to the Warriors, Howard going to the Rockets, and Andrew Bynum, the weak sauce, knee-injured filled center, going to the Cavaliers. All that and more I'll be doing a season on NBA 2K14 coming when it comes out. So expect that in around a month or two. And, finish off, thank you for, letting me be on your show. It's always a fun time, and hope you have a nice trip to Toronto as you're leaving Saturday.
Thank you, Steven, and I will talk to you later. Steven Hughes from National Sports. And to wrap up the show, go on Facebook, go check out National Sports. Go on Twitter, follow National Sports 1. Thank you for listening to my show. Well, as I say, another show of Deets Sports Talk. And, I'm just happy that I get a lot of people that are supportive of this. I go to a camp every year, and how it started, we got a lot of people in this now. A lot of people, some people do shows, and, people are just busy with their schedules, and you have to understand that. So I want to give pluses for everyone that listened. Thank you, thank you. You're too kind. You're too kind. You're way too kind. And that was a good, thanks guys for giving me the crowd, and glad I got the applause there for a great show today. Final words I gotta say, Giants, they gotta step up their game. Good job for the Warriors, good acquisitions today, and you know, I'm glad Derek Jeter's back. Well, see you later, folks. This is the end of my show. Go Deets Sports Talk.